important topics. The Chinese economy, media, education, business, and the arts. And you'll think a lot about what China has been, what it will become, what are some of the tensions and pressure points for moving forward, and what can the U.S. and other countries around the world learn from China's experience. I don't know if that's on your agenda, but I hope it's something that you think about during the day. China has become increasingly important around university over the years. And I expect that's something that will continue. We have had incredible growth in the number of students here from Greater China at Brown. Just to give you some statistics, the class of 2008, so not so long ago, there were 131 applicants from Greater China and 14 students enrolled. By the class of 2017, not that many years later, we had over 1,000 applicants, 44 students were enrolled in that one class. We now have 305 graduate students from Greater China. And you know, if you look at the numbers, they're just going to increase over time. And I think it's really terrific that we have greater engagement with an increasingly important country in the world. The other thing I would note is that through a very purposeful strategy, Brown has been establishing some pretty strong collaborations with universities and partners in Greater China. Professor Ed Steinfeld, who will be teaching next, has come to us from MIT and will be taking a lead in strengthening and building really terrific collaborations. We have a program with the Chinese University of Hong Kong. Many of our students go there and spend time. Collaborations with Zhejiang, Nanjing, and other places that are developing. So that's all been a very positive development for Brown, and it's led us to learn more about China, do better scholarship and research on China, and bring scholars, practitioners from China to Brown, and just increase the flow, which is something that will only strengthen Brown, and I think only strengthen the experience for our students who are here. We have very active student organizations, as you can see. I went to a wonderful Chinese gala earlier this year, which was a social counterpoint to this event here, which is much more academic in nature. And we also have very active alumni organizations. Brown established several years ago a China Advisory Council, and that's a great group of people, Brown friends, Brown alumni, and others, who, again, give us advice on how we can broaden our ties with China and expand opportunities for students and others to come and benefit from a Brown education. So all of these are moving in a really great direction. Now, I would say that the discussion today on the Chinese dream is very much a part of what I see as Brown's dream. Our goal as a university is to support scholarship, education, and debate on issues of importance to society now and in the future. And if you look at Brown's mission statement, it talks about the importance of scholarship and education for serving the community, the nation, and the world. And you know, any of you who've been here at Brown for any length of time, for the students who are here in the audience and others who teach here, you know that you know, the Brown culture is very much about connecting the academic experience to real world experiences. It's trying to take what we learn here and do here and apply it to improvement in the world. This idea of engagement is just kind of central to the DNA, baked into the DNA of Brown University. Over the last year and a half, we've been doing strategic planning at Brown, and it's something that I started when I came here. I've been here, this is my second academic year. And the strategic plan lays out areas of focus, areas of investment that Brown will conduct in the coming decade. And there are a number of areas, and I just want to lay them out and then say briefly how I think our relationship with China, scholarship with China, relates to the overall themes that we're talking about at Brown. So there are three main points in the strategic plan. The first one is I think of it as investing in people. And when you look at it, a university is only as strong as the people who populate it, the faculty, the students, the staff, and the alumni who are engaged, parents, friends, and others. And if we want to continue to improve our stature as an outstanding university that conducts research and education for the benefit of society, we have to make very strong investments in our people. that means, among one, making investments in people who work in China. And I've been, again, working with Professor Steinfeld on increasing our strength in China studies defined broadly. That means stronger financial aid for international students. Right now, Brown is need-blind for domestic students. It's need-aware for international students. And one of the planks of the strategic plan is to expand financial aid so that we can become need-blind for our international students as well. I think that would greatly diversify, increase the number of international students who we can have on campus, but also give us more breadth and diversity in the types of students who come to Brown. Again, think about China, right? It's such a huge place, diverse place, with talented students from across the country. And right now, I think we're only tapping a small part of the talent that we could be tapping within the country. So that's something that's very important. Another major point of the strategic plan is what we think of as engaged scholarship. And this is building our curriculum, building our educational programs so that Brown students have more ways to connect what they're learning on campus to what's going on in the world. And that means connecting what's going on locally, right here in Providence, right here in Rhode Island, but it also means making international connections. So, you know, one of my goals is to make sure that our students have a chance to experience, have international experiences. It also means having more opportunities for bringing people from around the world to Brown, to give this place more of an international feel. So over the coming decade, what I hope we'll be doing is bringing more, you know, visiting professors, practitioners, diplomats, policymakers, business leaders, and something like this panel that's bringing those very people from China to Brown fits very much in this model of engaged scholarship and the vision that we see for Brown going forward. The last big part of the strategic plan is what we call integrative themes. And these are areas of research and education that cut across disciplines. They build on Brown's very long and proud tradition of being a very open campus, intellectually open, so that students and faculty, in part because of the open curriculum, but also for a variety of other reasons, feel very comfortable working across disciplinary boundaries. They're comfortable connecting public health to economics, to biology, and you know, you can go through many different examples of some very strong cross-cutting collaborations. And what we've done in the plan is lay out a set of areas where we'll be making major investments. And you know, if you actually, I'm not going to go through the whole plan, don't worry. But if you go through those and you look at those integrated themes and you say, where would China fit into this? It would fit into almost everyone and probably everyone. So just to give you a couple examples, one of the integrated themes is creating peaceful, just, and prosperous societies. This is an area where we envision making major investments at Brown in things like the Watson Institute for International Studies, in things like our China initiative, as well as our India initiative and our Brazil initiative, so that students and faculty here at Brown can really study the complex interplay of politics, economics, sociology, that govern how well influence how well societies do and how they grow and how they're governed, but also connects those ideas into things like the environment and public health and international security, ideas that are just very important for moving forward. Another of the integrative themes is cultivating creative expression. And I was very happy to see that one of your panels here is on the arts in China. You know, I think of the arts as being actually vitally important to the life of a liberal arts university, because it's through the arts and through the study and understanding of culture that we can come back and think about how to create creative, peaceful, just, and prosperous societies. So the arts are not disconnected from this overall mission of improving society. Two more themes that I'll just note briefly, and they may not be so much on the agenda today, but maybe they're things that you'll consider for future summits. One is on environment and society. Maybe you'll talk about it today, maybe you won't. But the environmental issues facing this country, all countries of the world, China, on how to grow, how to balance energy demands that go with growth against the demands to create a cleaner environment to reduce climate change. This is a crucial debate, and it's something that everybody needs to pay attention to. Another integrative theme is deciphering disease and improving population health. This is something that I care a lot about. I'm a health economist, and I've done work on health around the globe, some in Asia. And you know, I know anybody who works on China knows that some of the health issues of how you manage the development of a great healthcare system with a large and economically thriving population, but also a rapidly aging population. These are some challenges that China's facing, but that many countries around the world are facing. And this may be an area where what we learn from China may have implications for what we learn and lessons that we can apply to the rest of the world. So, you know, I hope I've given you some ideas for how what you're doing today ties into what Brown stands for and what we're trying to do. And I hope that I will be back next year and see the next incarnation of the China Summit here at Brown University. I think it's a terrific day. I'm very grateful that you're having it, and I hope you have a wonderful conversation. I can't stay, unfortunately, so I will hear about it from our students and hear about it from our faculty. So thank you very much.
As many of you can see, there's Hwasun Institute for International Studies there. That's the only sponsorship we have for this forum. And right now, we're going to invite the director of Hwasun Institute to give the second opening speech. And Edward Sedfield, welcome.
Thank you so much. Let me just, before I begin, make a small correction. I'm not the director of the Hwasun Institute. That's Professor Richard Locke, but I'm honored to be the director of the China Initiative at the Hwasun Institute. 好，我想换一个位，先生女士。我很荣幸跟你们一起参加这次会。我非常表示感谢，感谢学生。这次会包括这个周末所有的活动，都是学生组织的。 特别表示感谢。我个人认为，这次会很重要，学生给我们做出很大的贡献。当然，这次会帮我们多了解中国的，包括台湾、中国大陆、香港、中国的发展过程。可是，我个人认为更重要的是，这个周末我们有非常好的机会来借鉴中国的。 发展过程，会让我们更加深入了解我们自己、全世界的发展过程。对我来说，这是一个在教育方面一个非常好的机会，必须抓住这个机会。我希望这次会，或者有这种会，会完全改善我们在教育方面的角度、方向。所以，谢谢。 I'll just quickly say in English, I want to thank you all and tell you how honored I am to be able to participate with you in this weekend's meeting. I, of course, especially want to thank the students who organized everything this weekend, along with our wonderful staff at the Hwasun Institute. Christy Kilgus is sitting in the back of the room, who worked incredibly hard with students to put together these events. Personally, I think it's, of course, very important to understand China, and a meeting like this helps us to understand China. But even more important, I feel that our mission is to learn from the greater Chinese development experience, including the mainland, Taiwan, Hong Kong, really to help us improve and completely change our whole approach to education So I am looking forward to the events today and tomorrow as much, I hope, as you are, and I greatly look forward to learning together with you. Thank you.
接下来我们会有我们峰会的主席讲话，也会有两位非常有名的教授带来他们的 keynote speech。然后，那我就简短的说一下我的自己从自己的方面的一个中国梦吧。大家可以看到，我们这次的会议主题是我的中国梦。 这个是唯一一个当时团队在讨论的时候没有任何 objections 的一个想法，因为我觉得在座的每个人，每个华人他即使在美国，他也是有他自己的中国梦的。一会儿李小七教授和这个王祖耀先生会谈谈他们在中国大形势、经济形势下的他们所谓的中国梦。那我就讲讲我比较小的，我个人的中国梦。我的太爷爷是上海朱家角的一个镇长。 我不知道在座有多少人听说过朱家角这个地方，是一个很小的地方，但其实很漂亮。大家如果有下次有机会去上海的时候，有机会应该去看一看。他当镇长的时候，当时那个时候中国很穷，朱家角就更穷了。当时受了一笔捐款，收到这笔捐款的时候，他有三个选择：修路、修庙还是建桥。然后当时他完全没有犹豫的决定去给老家建一座桥。这座桥通向上海。 从此朱家角的人走去上海就更容易了。有了这一座桥之后，慢慢的走出去上大学的人越来越多。我的奶奶爷爷当时去了同济上了大学，我的爸爸妈妈离开了南方去了北方去了北京工作，然后我现在在美国。我觉得这些一切都跟这座桥有很大的关系。后来改革开放之后渐渐的富起来了，路不修了，因为说坑坑洼洼的小路是一个当地特色。 都保持了，庙也被拆了，只有桥一直在还在，现在桥还在。如果大家有机会去朱家角看，那叫蔡家桥。现在这个桥不仅仅是大家在走出去走去上海的一条路，更是让越来越多的外地人，甚至外国人来朱家角看的，引来越来越多的人来朱家角看这样的一条路。我的中国梦很简单，就是我希望今后自己能做一座桥。 在全球化的今天，不仅仅是政治、经济、沟通，更应该是文化。我相信今天在座的所有嘉宾，他们都花了很多很多的努力在做这座桥，也取得了很大的社会影响。所以我今天觉得非常荣幸，能请你们来，然后希望我们都能实现所谓的我的中国梦。谢谢大家。 就有请我们这次峰会的主席。我觉得很荣幸的一件事情是，这次峰会能够跟我很多非常好的朋友一起去共同完成一项工作。张恩琪就是我大一时候最好的朋友，然后他现在是做了很多很多的工作和努力。接下来有请他，用英语讲一讲他的中国梦。
Hi everyone, welcome. I'm Kiki Lingqi Zhang, president of Brown China Summit 2014. I'm a junior here at Brown. First of all, on behalf of Brown China Summit team, I would love to thank you all for coming and especially our guest speakers and moderators, including my mom. Without your help and support, we wouldn't have gone so far. And I would love to thank Brown University, Watson Institute, and particularly Christina Petson, although she just left, and Professor Edward Steinfeld for helping us to fulfill our dream, which is holding such an awesome summit today. And also Christy, who is the event manager from Watson Institute, who she just left as well. Second of all, I want to introduce our brilliant team members to all of you. I will read through the list, please acknowledge them in the end. Yi Moli, the Director of Operations, and He Mingjian, the Director for Public Relations. Sima Zhu, Director of Informational Technology. Hai Chungao, Director of Keynote Speech. Ting Xia, Co-Director of Education Panel. Xi Hu, Co-Director of Education Panel. Si Yu Chen, Co-Director of Media Panel. Ao Ying Huang, Co-Director of Media Panel. Zheng Yanggao, Co-Director of Business Panel. Shuo Wang, Co-Director of Business Panel. Every single of them have made great efforts to the summit, and today, at this moment, we could finally proudly announce that we made it. Brown China Summit is a student-led event sponsored by Watson Institute, as Professor Edward Steinfeld just mentioned. The summit aims to further develop communication between Brown students and also great guest speakers from all over the world. We want to provide as much resources as we could to the students to inspire them about their future career path and also their life. So this weekend, we gathered 17 guest speakers and four moderators to talk about their personal experiences in four panels: education, business, media, and art. It feels unreal that I'm really standing here to kick off this event. As Jenny just mentioned, the idea of Brown China Summit was formed last summer. However, it wasn't until 195 days ago, on September 22nd, 2013, 10 of us had gathered around to have our first team meeting, during which we agreed on this theme, My Chinese Dream. We started from scratch, and Brown China Summit has been an important part in our lives since then. 157 days ago, our main logo with both Brown logo and Watson logo embedded was finalized. 163 days ago, we sent out our first invitation letter to intended guest speakers, and 10 days later, we got the first confirmation letter from the speaker. After that, we continually received more and more confirmation letters from our guest speakers. 45 days ago, February 19th, our website, brownchina.org, launched online. 32 days ago, we opened a registration for our summit. And today, here we are for the great summit this weekend. I could keep going on if needed, but what I want to say is that all of us tried our best to make this happen. And I hope each of you will enjoy the summit this weekend. Last, I just want to thank you all again for your great support to our Brown China Summit.
之所以有这个荣幸，是因为李小溪教授给我们带来第一个演讲。之所以有幸提前聊天，我跟他聊天的时候，他说他是老三届。我觉得当时我不是很理解这个概念，然后我相信在座可能也有很多不是很明白这个概念的同学。他指的是说，1966、1968三届初高中毕业生。 他们很多后来当了知青，上山下乡，是中国这个特殊时期非常特殊的一批人。用李教授自己的话讲，他是中国社科院读万卷书，后来又到了国务院行万里路。今天。
天他将给我们带来宏观背景下、经济形势下的所谓的他的中国梦。谢谢他，谢谢李教授，有请。
Thank you, everybody. Good morning. And I thank this summit and the invitation for me. I stand here and I'm very happy. And this younger people is the organizer of this summit. It's very good. Let me speak in Chinese and let me use short time. 我想呢，我对中国梦谈谈自己的理解和体会。首先呢，这个工会这个组织呢，我感觉到是很有。确实我感到我是没想到突然有这样的一个峰会，我正想到罗德岛来玩一玩，公司兼顾了又来看看罗德岛，我们参加峰会。那么我想呢，这个几天前呢，正好我们的国家习近平主席呢访问了荷兰、法国、德国、比利时，他多角度的专门讲了中国梦。这样的话呢，我想我讲这个时候呢，可以把他讲的很多内容呢也可以这个给大家简单地再谈谈我的理解吧。因为我觉得他讲这次几个国家讲的中国梦讲得非常非常有意思，非常好。那么我就把它概括个五环中国梦了啊，有复兴梦、幸福梦、和平梦、中国梦、继承文明的梦、奉献世界的梦。他在法国讲的时候主要讲了幸福梦，追求幸福、追求和平和奉献世界。但是我们知道中国复兴梦这个是在十八大的专门讲的复兴梦，而在我在自己感觉到的一块儿讲特别多的中国的文化给你，因此我觉得这个传承文明也是个梦，因此我就把它搞了个叫五环中国梦。首先我先讲个影子吧，因为这个大会组织者说你一定要结合你的实际讲讲你的经历，你这个学经济学的不能讲经济学理论讲得太枯燥，我们大家想听生动的。我说那好吧，那我就讲讲我的简历吧。大家看看我这张照片呢，那就是我上山下乡时照片，前面一排毛主席像杆。那是那个时候就是根据毛主席的号召要去到农村去，我们就下了乡了。我是老三届，也就是老六七的高中生，马上就要考大学了。然后呢，我又是新七七的大学生，七七级恢复高考也是第一届的大学生。因此既是老三届又是新三届。那么我为什么讲中国梦，主要把自己讲一讲呢？因为实际上你做的梦啊，如果是国家形势变了，你这个梦有的是白做。你比如说上中学的时候，我们就特别想我们这个时候以后长大了当个科学家，那时候我最想当科学家，要不然看了小说以后我想当个文学家，看了天上星星想当个天文学家，然后看了个电影片说谁谁小提琴拉的好，这个是苏联电影片，哎呀我想当个音乐家，那永远都做这些梦。但是实际上这些梦啊，你如果整个社会环境变了，这些梦是没法做的。比如说我上中学就在批白砖道路，你们都年轻人根本不知道什么叫白砖道路，就说你以后学习啊，学习要好，而且必须要红，就又红又砖。那个时候我是学习比较好的，我就懵了，因为我有可能被当做白砖典型了，我也不知道我为什么白，我为什么红，很复杂。到了中学的时候，到了以后我们特别想以后到大学，我特别想读一下托尔斯泰的战争与和平啊，找也找不见，当时大学图书馆什么书都有，我就想上大学以后好好看看小说。那个时候赶上文化大革命，文化大革命说这些封建的资本主义的通通都要烧掉啊，要破四旧立四新。赶上文化大革命，我们这个梦就没法实现了。七七年恢复高考以后，这个改革开放就给我们个历史机遇，对我们这一届人呢，我们就上了那个十年以后吧，又上山下乡，又去工作，以后呢就上了大学了。上了大学以后呢，就到了这个中国社会科学院读的硕士和博士，啊，那么这样一些机会呢，就是呢改革开放呢给我们这样的机会，使得我们这一代人呢，确确实实是比较特殊的，啊，因此我要说我的英语，我现在真不敢说很好。我虽然我在伦敦经济学院待过将近一年，现在在哈佛访问学者，但是你们知道我们那个时代我们学俄语的，全学俄语，因此我是学了俄语，以后要自学英语。现在我现在 如果说英语能够对付一个会听不久的经济学讲一次课用英语讲，但是大家知道我的英语讲课是很累很累的，讲到最后的单词都快尿出来了，就感到非常累。为什么？我们毕竟这个十年时间最年轻的时候学外语最好的时间全部耽误了，我们感到非常累。那么我就想想，想到这儿呢，我就想想个人和国家的关系。我举了个例子，我的1999年出了论文集的时候呢，我自己就在问，我在自序里说，人类思想是环境的产物呢，还是环境是人类思想的产物？个人的作品是环境的产物，还是个人努力的结果，还是两者的结合？我自己认为，我个人的努力的重要性，不能或者说低于环境变迁对学问重要性。说白了，我认为我们个人微不足道，实际上环境变迁提供了我们的一个最好的舞台。我在社科院的时候，我是联系国家那个当时的农业中心，也就是现在的王岐山同志，当时他是副处长，我是和他联系，当时去搞80年代的这个改革调研什么什么，那个时候就给我们提供了一个参加改革开放论坛大好机会，使得我那时发表了很多文章，现在大家发一篇文章好难，太多的人去发那个东西了，可是那个时候我们发文章太容易了，因为我们去调研回来就有文章，调研回来回来就有文章，并不存在发几篇，我硕士先发了20多篇，为什么？调研太多。那么进了大学以后呢，在这个国庆30周年，我就写了一个小词，因为今天大家叫经济学，你不能太经济学，说搞文学的多，搞艺术多，我也浪漫浪漫，我也写就我把小词也给大家念两句啊。当时正赶上30周年国庆，我就写了这么几句：革命喜10月，极度风里长安街，红了枫叶。阵阵关山重头月，老将上马国体重抖擞，壮怀激烈。茫茫草地万里尘，再一番草雪半霜，草面半霜雪。等等等等的嘛，还有个念诗，补天人安在，悄然四书事业。实际上当时就还是有一种寄托，就是这一批人读书的人，将来都是要承担重任的嘛。实际上现在大家都说了，老三届的一批现在都在国家领导岗位上，也到这个年龄了，也不见得你们到那个年龄也是要上的，不管你们是哪一届。对吧？这就是大学在2年级的时候呢，我很感慨，因为我觉得这个风风雨雨对我们影响太大了。那么这张图大家可能没有这么看过，这是中南海的图，但是这也不是什么机密啊。这个大家可以看那个门呢，就是长安街那个门，一进去以后大家可能想象不到，一进去后全是水，然后中间的就是银海，就是银海。我工作的地点呢在后面，我是在中海。这个前面这一片呢，靠南边这个是党中央工作的地方，北边是国务院工作的地方。我在国务院工作了8年。我自己这张照片呢是在紫光阁前面照的，那时候。然后从2001年我就提出来，我想还是回到大学去啊。然后我这写了个小诗，就是当时看到那个风景以后，就想着人生如景随景变，他若须非经世楼。上北京师范大学校领导来找我。北大的也通过了，我要调我到北大。后来我说谁能够安排我的学校住，北京师范大学我们可以，北师大说我们校委没办法安排了，那我说我到北师大，我也不图这个什么，我就到了北师大。那么这在北师大这里有一点小小的事情，大家看这张照片里面，其实很多人物是非常重要的人物，有余光远，有杜润生，有宋涛，在座的年轻人可能好多都不知道。余光远先生是中华人民共和国成立以后的第一任的宣传部的文理论处处长。余老师我最尊敬的老人，他已经去世了啊。我们3周年的时候我就请了5个老人过来，宋涛老人也去世了，他是人民大学的。然后还有杜润生是领导中国改革开放以后的农村改革，是杜老在领导。这一批人我们请来，还有王达老师，还有这个我自己的导师张卓元老师。他社科院的原来当过工经所财贸所的所长，我这里有个小诗，这小诗为什么说这些呢？三个是我自己前面，童年少年，这山间小溪在花丛中流淌，每一种虫道和色彩都成为长着翅膀的理想，天上的星星抚摸着渴望宇宙的目光，迷人的小说编织着人少年文豪的狂想，小提琴手成长的故事带着孩子。这个梦中的音乐殿堂，丰富多彩迷人眼，左顾右盼寻起点，哪里是未来的香港？因为我成立的时候呢，我们院呢，我一个人到了北师大，然后现在已经成立一个院了， 那个时候我成立是六月一号，为什么选了六月一号呢？因为余光远老先生，我们参加1999年或者2000年会的时候，他说我是新世纪的好儿童，哎，我就很感慨，光远先生说他新世纪的好儿童，那么我们呢就把这一天就定，我就到六月一号去报道，啊，就成了这一天。那么当时这个会上，余光远先生还问台下的小孩子们，因为当时幼儿园的孩子来了很多，你们说，你们都说人会越来越老，人可能不可能人越变越年轻？有个小孩子说我知道，哎，那你说，他说如果心还年轻就会越来越年轻，余光远说说得好。实际上我们就和孩子们在一个做个对话，啊，这也是我觉得这一辈老人们他们真是非常不简单。好了，现在咱们就言归正传了，前面就是根据大会要求我还比较简单的。现在言归正传，首先我讲中国梦是中华民族伟大复兴的梦，啊，习主席讲了，我们要实现中国梦要两个100的奋斗目标，2020年要实现国内生产总值和城乡居民收入比2010年翻一番，建成小康，到了本世纪中叶建成现代化的国家。实际上这个的三步走，在最早的时候小平同志也提过，本世纪中叶的时候要成为这个现代文明的这个就是现代化国家，啊，这个我就举几个经济数据来看看我们的中国梦。在公元1000年到1600年间，中国人均 GDP 是世界的平均水平。在1820年的时候，中国 GDP 总量是世界总量的1/3，好大呀，是吧？然后十八大提出，从2010年到2020年 ，GDP 总量从40万亿要到80万亿，年均增长速度7%，我们就可以达到。那么这个7%就会低于我们前30年平均。我们前30年是9.3%，你看我们只要7%我们就能达到，而且我们的居民收入以后增长要高于 GDP 增长。国际货币基金组织 IMF 它就预测我们的购买力评价是2016年总量超过美国，但人均还是为美国的1/4，就是中国按现在的这个步骤往下走下去，经济总量以后会成为世界第一。但这个确实我们想想，我们13亿人口一点骄傲不起来，对吧？我们经济总量，因为当年1820年的时候，我们已经是那绝对世界第一了，对吧？我们现在希望每人均都要上来才行，而且需要更多的还是需要我们大家生活过好，不光是看 GDP 了。那么我简单的说一下，2014年国外很多金融机构来判断中国经济增长速度，他们最后的均值大家可以看看是7.4，包括世行的、高盛的、花旗银行的、瑞银的、渣打的等等。我们自己每个季度也在做形势分析，我们分析的我们算是7.5，啊，但这些东西我们是用几种模型来做，这个就不多说了。那么在分析经济增长的时候，很多人说，经济中国还能不能保持这个7%或者8%或者更高一点速度增长10年20年？又很乐观的说，中国经济啊8-9%增长20年没问题。大概这是以我们的老朋友林毓夫他喜欢说这样的话。但他这句话我们现在可能有点疑问，就是9%的话这样增长，中国是20年是有点问题。最早这句话是世界银行斯登，首席经济学家斯登教授，他说中国可以高速增长20年的，这是我是看过他的报告，而且我在伦敦经济学院里当时就跟着他，那么我自己是这样理解这个问题。我们要看中国经济增长的持续，我们一个要看叫三驾马车，消费、投资、外贸，后面有四个轮子，有劳动、资本、技术、资源、环境，啊，我们现在三大需求的来讲还是很大的，啊，因为外国朋友一来到沿海一看，哇，中国这么厉害，都是发达国家了，你到我们中西部看看还很穷，这种穷这种差距意味着什么？意味着还是需要投资，啊，意味着我们消费这个提升还是有很大的空间，意味着我们的对外出口各方面我们还是有很多空间的。但是这个是短期的，现在如果把三驾马车这三个的分析老把它当作一个长期的时候，那是有问题的。宏观经济学告诉我们这是短期分析，年度分析，真正有影响的是后面的四个轮子啊。那么这四个轮子现在有没有问题呢？资本问题并不大啊，现在不是少而是多啊。劳动问题呢，现在说到了刘易斯拐点，所以刘易斯拐点就是农村人口转移到城市已经到了高峰以后，再往后走是不可能了。但这个现在也分了第一拐点、第二拐点，刘易斯本身也有个纠正，那这就不多详细说了。这个拐点我们证明现在还是有一定的潜力，不是没有潜力啊。 资源环境这块的问题非常大。如果我们的高速度是以牺牲资源环境来做的，不值得，真是不值得。我们的水被污染了，我们的这个天空雾霾了，你说我们要这样的高增长有什么用处呢？如果是降低了这种污染，我们得到的是一个经济增长6%-7%，我们觉得值当。因此我们现在自环这块是这个轮子啊，至少有一个轮子现在已经扁了，走起来是摇摇摆摆的，技术问题也不存在。中国一旦做起来，技术问题不是特别大。一个，我们愿意引进技术，18大讲了6种技术，对吧？其中还有一种最重要的技术，就是我们中国人的首创精神也是很强的，对吧？我们现在以后互联网金融这个，哎呀，走的真是够快的，啊！上次这个周先生他带了7个人过来以后，路上还说呢，如果我们有个高铁过来1个多小时，叫你们等了我们好3-4个小时，我们堵车了，是吧？
你走了七个小时，
对，从那个纽约到了波士顿。我们的技术很多问题，我们有一批大量的一批科学家，我们能上到月亮上去，这个全世界也没几家。而技术呢，只要有少数科学家做完以后，大家就可以应用，包括我们这些这个运用这个电脑这些东西，难道需要每个人都要从那儿比尔盖茨盖茨吗？用不着，有那么一批人，然后就把全世界社会带起来了，对吧？因此我对这个还充满信心的，包括我现在用做这个软件，大家可以看看，这就是苹果上面带你个模板，好简单，往上面一贴就过来了，对吧？因此呢，我对这个也很有信心。我唯一感到最大的问题是资源环境，当然我们资本、劳动、技术各方面也还不是一点问题没有啊，我觉得这个里面还是有问题，可以说资本风险不小，劳动转换在转换期，技术创新还有力量，这架马车可以继续走，速度可以下，可能要下降，但是我觉得7%这么走，我觉得再增长5年没什么问题。大家说为什么在5年说那么短？因为5年我就70岁，很多的事留给年轻人去预测吧，我预测永远干嘛，对吧？我到了70岁，我应该休息了，对吧？我们应该去好好的，再不要老再给年轻人。所以年轻人，我相信你们是有这个能力的。以后更远的预测你们要做，祖国的希望还在你们身上。那第二个追求和平的梦，这个修水讲的有好多话特别好，对吧？大家可以看一看，就是他举那个拿破仑的话，拿破仑说世界上有2种力量，利剑和思想，从长而论，利剑总是败在思想之下，然后是中国的狮子啊，是和平的。我给大家讲一讲，就是我对这个拿破仑这句话，包括习主席这句话的理解。其实啊，现在这个我们要不要拿出利剑，要不然去搏斗，和我们的思想关系太大了啊。我给大家讲，联共不党史，在座的肯登你们看过的人我估计太少了，苏联共产党括号21个党史谁看过？斯大林写的，其中讲到物理变化、化学变化，说物理变化就是一种量的变化，化学变化就会发光发热，因此革命什么？革命就是流血，就是暴力，就是牺牲。哎呀，这些东西对我们年轻人影响太大了。那么我们杀人放火，这不就革命吗？这不就是质变吗？这不就是化学反应吗？大家知道理论对思想影响有多大，拿破仑说的多对啊。你为什么要去杀人？当了你有一种理念的时候，你可能杀他的时候，你想他是阶级敌人啊，他是阻碍社会的发展者，他是反动派，这个时候你就有这个勇气杀他。因此我们的思想是特别重要啊，这个利剑就要靠思想。我们当年作为红卫兵的时候完全是狂热的，对不对？我们就觉得啊，这个炸弹救世界啊，是造反有理啊，感到非常有道理，实际上就是一种理念的支撑。回过头我们现在就感觉到那个时候好多东西做的是很不好的，文化大革命在座的很多不了解，以为觉得就是对了官僚阶层怎么样，其实呢是中国传统文化的一个大破坏。那么价值观现在已经发生天大的变化，在座的人你们可能不了解，当时打倒了刘少奇、邓小平一大堆人，用了一个词叫黑三论，周先生应该知道黑三论什么呢？阶级斗争熄灭论、资产阶级人性论、唯生产力论。黑三论是天大的帽子，扣到哪里打到哪。现在呢，建设和谐社会，这不就阶级斗争熄灭论翻了个个了吧？我们现在讲以人为本，而不提以什么阶级为本，那以资产阶级人性论以人为本，又是天翻地覆的变化 啊，现在我们讲经济建设为中心，这也是天翻地覆的变化，好，不多讲了。这个意思就是这个，这个，而且核还有助于我们理解社会主义市场经济，这个我也没时间我不说了。啊，也就是我们以后讲什么关于阶级问题，我们如果没有一种阶级合作的思想，光有阶级斗争思想，非常可怕。对立统一是既要斗还要和，和是重要的。那么领导人还谈到我们的这个幸福，什么叫幸福啊？我现在这段只讲了一个点，为什么中国贪污问题这么严重？如果贪污很多钱，老百姓干的钱都被人拿跑了，都被贪污了，你说我们感到幸福吗？因此我就讲了一点，当时我在2000年的时候发表一篇文章，专门讲我希望一个政府要把你作为资产所有者的管理权利和作为社会管理者的权利分开。因为我们有的时候又是资产的管理者，所以国有企业，有的时候又是社会管理者，两个权利经常交错，交错的结果你现在看看，现在出事好多出在最大的一批央企的资产谁拿走，我特别担心。因此我向国企改革的时候把这个权利分开，防止以后出现很多腐败。这是2000年时候写的文章发表的，我2001年是离开国务院，但是我现在感觉到这个问题现在好严重啊，这个国资的流失，很多资产就成了少数人的，政治没有分开。好，第四个是传承文明内容。啊，习主席讲的文明是多彩的，文明是平等的，文明是包容的。啊，只要有包容精神，就不会有什么文明冲突。文明冲突是很有名的一本书。那么我们现在讲文明包容，这很有意思。讲到儒教、儒道释，啊，这个都非常好。那我们想一想。我们历史上我们对孔子一会儿要批的一会儿打的，有那个必要吗？我现在真觉得我们反孔，好多细节想起来，我们自己后人走到今天这一步，我们落后了，我们什么都归到孔子，其实真是有，我觉得孔子太冤枉了啊，对吧？他在那个时候能讲到有教无类，能发明那么多教育的东西，包括我们大家在座的好多论语中间那么多道德的东西，怎么就是孔子使得我们中国落后了呢？而现在到处是孔子学院，全世界交流，包括美国议会认为孔子这个很重要，对不对？因此我们现在回想一下，我们不能过分的否定，包括老子道德经，全世界圣经以外的翻译的发现量最大的就是老子的道德经。我现在各高校去我都在查各种版本，我已经准备了好多各国版本，我看了大概有几十个国家的，我希望在座的同学们咱们一块来，有没有可能我们收集全世界的各种文字的道德经，我想给他做一个碑林这样的东西，实在觉得我们全世界都那么尊重我们的这个古人，而我们自己老在弄，就把我们古人批倒了。这个对宗教，我在1978年的时候，刚刚改革开放完的时候，建了一篇文章，使得我大开脑筋。我们原来以为什么呢？我们以为宗教鸦片啊，吃了很糟糕，宗教封建迷信，天上哪来个鬼啊？你杀人放火也不用怕担心鬼叫，半夜有鬼叫的，没有的，当然没有。因此就杀吧，没事儿，是吧？这个1978年，我看那篇小说叫什么呢？叫做《晚霞烧红的时候》，他在里面有三句话，我听了以后非常的受启发。他说：“艺术讲的是美，科学讲的是真，宗教讲的是善。”哇，他这个对我启发太深了。这么多年过去了，我这几句话我脑子里想，我们老在用科学来衡量宗教。这是真的吗？啊，那个什么，你见过吗？什么？其实他讲的是善的，我们怎么能这样低估呢？这次你看看，总书记又讲了这个宗教的问题，而且16大第一次提出发挥宗教的建设和谐社会中作用，太重要了，对吧？我们去了好多保护了我们大自然的、保护了我们千年古树的地方，在哪里？在道观里，在寺庙里，我们怎么不能感谢他们呢？他们保护了我们多少传统的那么多上千年的树啊，不多说了。第5，奉献世界联盟。总书记说了啊，这个伊斯兰教、佛教、基督教的传入中国，讲文明如水润物无声啊，我们叫互相那个什么，还有穷者独善其身，达者兼济天下。这句话原来天下死的中国9州了，这句话用到这儿那就是兼济全世界了啊。那我就简单讲一讲，我们现在做一个报告啊，我们做了一个人类绿色发展报告2014年版啊，我们将这个报告呢啊，这个13原来的老写错了， 我们用了12个指标，大概简单概括就是吃饱喝净、健康卫生、教育脱贫、天然气爽、地绿和气、生物共存，找了12个指标来衡量123个国家的绿色发展。那么在我在哈佛的时候，我给那个斯泰勒先生写了封信，他是联合国副秘书长，同时是环境规划署的署长，他给我回了封信，说很高兴听到你们搞的人类绿色发展指数报告，可以给我们写个序，同时希望我们做好中国绿色发展指数。那么这就是我们做的中国绿色发展指数，从2001年到2003年，我们以后还年年做。这一本是德国斯普林格出版社给我们出的这个英文，2011年的，2012年的英文版马上就来。嗯，我们要坚持做下去。中国不绿不行啊，中国的绿色影响着全世界。现在中国是排二氧化碳排放量是第一大国了，超过美国了，非常恐惧啊！我们以后中国，我们搞好我们自己中国的环境，就是为世界做贡献。现在全世界的关心，我们这次的交流，我在24号的环境学院可能还有一个专门讲，我们关于绿色问题，都特别重要。这是我们全世界联手做的，一条河，湄公河，多少个国家，一边污染了，像我们这边上游污染了，下面就都很麻烦。对吧？因此需要合作，最需要合作。想，我想这也是我们想做的一点贡献。最后呢，会想给献上一个小诗，也表现我对传统文化的热爱，对吧？因为一个峰会，我在泰山上写了一首小诗。杜甫是诗圣，还是你们都这首诗大家都很熟，对吧？岱宗夫未了，齐鲁青未了，等等等等。我在我右边是我写的老牛，因为我属牛，我叫老牛登月了。这下面这个照片是清华北大一大批人，当时我组织这个泰山论坛请他们来，大家可以对着看一看啊。3年之如何，冬月清微了，盘膝百岩秀，登高千里小，天阶半祥云，春庭闻啼鸟，山高人未顶，回眸群峰小，全部是押他的韵，偷了个懒，但是也表明了我们对古人，我是非常非常崇敬咱们的古人，他们是了不起的，我们永远达不到他们高峰，但是他们对我们这一代人以后对我们将来的影响是非常大的，只有这样才能叫外国人看得起我们。30年代一个美国作家到中国回来就说，中国虽然穷，但是他感觉到中国人特别有志气。你的妈妈会告诉你，你出去做生意千万不能搞那些歪门邪道。现在的情况变化好大呀，对不对？我们现在一定要想想为什么会这样，是传统文化在告诉我们，我们把传统文化批得太多了，对吧？我们的一个老太太摔到街上，我们在想，我能扶她吗？她会不会是一个阶级敌人呢？这是我们原来的概念，现在她会不会什么叫什么创碰瓷啊？什么词儿多得很了。现在为什么我们传统文化好多被削弱了？我们不要忽略我们传统文化。好，谢谢。一会儿通知。
接下来的一位演讲者，我相信国父孙中山大家一定都非常熟悉。接下来的演讲者是孙中山先生的曾孙子王祖耀先生。曾经孙中山先生希望建立一个平等、自由、博爱、天下为公的中国，而今天王祖耀先生会结合现代中国，谈谈他和他祖先的中国梦。Welcome, Dr.
President Christina Paxson, Professor Edward Steinfeld, Liu Jiani, Zhang Yunqi, members of the Watson Institute, Yu Shimen, Chen Shengmen, Lao Shimen, Hong Shimen, Da Jia Hao. It is a great honor and pleasure for me to speak at the Brown China Summit 2014. When talking about the China Dream, I would like to reintroduce you to the biggest dreamer of all, Sun Chongsun. Today, Sun Chongsun still represents the hopes, dreams, and aspirations of the Chinese people. And I would like to share his dream with all of you here today. President Xi Jinping and other top Chinese national leaders recently paid a visit to the National Museum's Road to Revival, 在北京天安门广场的国家博物馆，以复兴之路。习近平总书记讲，我们现在都讨论中国梦，我以为实现中华民族的伟大的复兴，是中华民族近代最大的中国梦。从改革开放开始以来，总结历史经验，找到了一条实现中华民族的伟大的复兴的正确道路。这正确道路就是有中国的特色的社会主义。找到一个正确的道路是多么的不容易。道路决定命运。历史告诉我们，我们每一个人的个人的前途命运，都是和这个国家的前途命运，都是和这个民族的前途命运有密切关系。大家好，啊，国家好，人民好，大家才会好。In this picture, you can see Xi Jinping and the other top Chinese national leaders in the National Museum's Road to Revival. They're looking up at a picture of Sun Chongsun. And Xi Jinping said, 中华民族的伟大的复兴是从孙中山的辛亥革命开始的。孙中山是第一个人提出来振兴中华的口号。So here you can see a book that is titled 孙中山振兴中华思想研究。Who can tell me what 孙中山的振兴中华思想 is? Can anybody name one of his books or some of his writings? 三民主义。How about another one?
实业救国。
事业计划，
实业救国，
事业救国 ，it's actually 事业计划 ，which is a part of a 建国方略。So 三民主义 is 民族、民权、民生 ，which represents 民有、民主、民享 ，a republic of the people, governed by the people, for the benefit of the people。孙中山的梦想不就是他个人的梦想，是我们全中华民族的梦想，建立一个自由、平等、博爱和天下为公的中国。So I'd like to discuss a little bit about 孙中山的三民主义。When we talk about 中华民族， do any of you know that we're actually talking about a 理想？是中华民族是孙中山一个人提出来的，是孙中山的理想，怎么把中国团结起来。Before 孙中山 there was no concept of the Chinese nationality. There's, you know, 汉族、满族、蒙族、维吾尔族、跟藏族，都是 the five big nationalities of China. So 孙中山是提出来五族共和。So, 民族主义 is China needs to be a strong, independent country, free from foreign domination, internally harmonious between the different ethnic groups, with a revival of China's culture. 这个是非常重要的。孙中山讲，在他的民族主义第六讲。要复兴我们的固有的道德的文化做新中国的基础。中国的精神 China's national spirit is its ancient moral culture. And he focused on the great learning from Confucius, 这个八德跟这个八目。忠孝仁爱信义和平。歌舞智者诚意真心修行齐家治国平天下。The next of Sun Zhongshan's principles is Mingquan, which he called the people's rights. And the people have a right to an equal and just government, a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. Sun Yat-sen said this is the hallmark feature of all modern countries with modern political systems. He said if a country does not have people's rights,It is not a true republic, because in a republic, the republic belongs to the people. 所以孙中山讲的是，每一个现代化的国家，现代化的政治制度，人民都是我这个共和国都是有民权的。要是没有民权的话，这个不是一个真的共和国。因为共和国是人民的。And then, basically, in his theory of the people's rights, he took the Montanesque system of the separation and balance of powers between the executive, legislative, and judicial branches, separation of powers, balance of powers, and then combined them. 把这个西方的政治制度跟这个中国传统的政治制度融合起来。And the two traditional Chinese political institutions are the 考试院 and the 检察院。所以 the five branches of government become 五权宪法。And then Sun advocated three stages of political development. 君政、训政。And then finally, Xian Zhang. And then, Mingsheng Zui is the people's livelihood. The people's livelihood is a multifaceted concept. It embodies China's industrial revolution, providing for the basic material needs of the people, focusing on housing, clothing, food,and then transportation, and all of which are aimed ultimately at the happiness of the people. 民生主义的目的是人民要幸福。And the other great work by Sun Zhongshan is Zhenpo Fang Lu. How many of you have heard of Sun Zhongshan the Zhenpo Fang Lu? Can anybody raise their hand?Two, three, four. Okay, the only four people out of the whole audience. The formal title, English title of Zhenpo Fang Lu is Plans for National Reconstruction. But can anybody think of a better translation of Zhenpo Fang Lu? Zhenpo, what is Zhenpo?Nation building, correct. And how about Fang Lu? Strategy, right. So a better English title for Zhenpo Fang Lu would probably be a strategy for nation building. How many of you have heard of the international development of China by Sun Yat-sen? One person, two. Only two people? The international development of China, does it sound interesting to you? I can assure you that it is very interesting. I first discovered the international development of China when I was a college student at Occidental College in Los Angeles. I found it in the library and I started reading it. What I read both shocked me and amazed me, and I asked myself, what am I reading? In the international development of China, Sun Yat-sen was to make many predictions that were to come true decades into the future and are still being realized today. The international development of China is actually the English translation of Sun Zhongshan the Shi Ye Qihua, which is a part of his Jianguo Fang Lu. Jianguo Fang Lu has three parts. Di Yi Bu Si San Wen Xue Shuo, Di Er Bu Si Shi Ye Qihua, Di San Bu Fen Si Xin Li Jian Se. Okay, so this is the map. This is Sun Zhongshan the Jing Qi Gong Yue Wei Hua the Wan Tu, the map of how to construct China's strategic industrial infrastructure. And if you look on the coastline, you'll see these red dots connected by these lines going into the interior. The characteristic feature of Sun Zhongshan, the Jianguo Fangliu Tu, is ports along China's eastern seaboard connected by railways running into the hinterland in the west. So this was all designed by Sun Zhongshan himself. The international development of China consisted of practical programs to develop China's economic and industrial infrastructure, concentrating on energy and transportation, and industries which provide every individual and family with the necessities and comforts of life, all with foreign capital, technology, and experts. Sun Zhongshan 中国没有自己的资本，没有自己的技术，没有自己的人才，要靠这个外国国际上的投资资金、技术跟人才，才可以把中国的经济发展起来。Central to Sun Zhongshan's vision was the development of three world-class ports on the scale of New York Harbor, because New York Harbor was the largest port in the world during this time. So these three world-class ports were designed to open China to the world, and open China to world trends, and were to be located in the north, the Great Northern Port, Beifang Dagang, in Tianjin. In the east, the Great Eastern Port, Dongfang Dagang, near Shanghai. And in the south, the Great Southern Port, Nanfang Dagang, in Guangzhou. So this is a map showing Sun Zhongshan's vision of how to use the Great Northern Port to facilitate Northern China's economic development linked by railways into the hinterland. You can see that the railway is crossing what is today Outer Mongolia, and then going all the way into Xinjiang, and then even beyond Xinjiang, you can see the railways running north of Mongolia, out of Mongolia. So this is how he envisioned that the Great Northern Port would contribute to Northern China's economic development, how the Great Eastern Port, linked by railways and the Changjiang, would contribute to Eastern and Central China's economic development, and how Great Southern Port, utilizing the Zhujiang and linked by railways to facilitate Southern China's economic development. This is a picture taken from the Sun Zhongshan Jingye Guan in Guangdong, Zhongshan, Cui Han Chuan. And it says, 发展国家的经济的理想与规划。And underneath it is this board which says, 该于是外国之资本主义以造就中国的社会主义而调和此人类进化之两种经济能力实质互相为用以促进将来世界之文明业。孙中山 In building this nation, I wish to bring foreign capitalism alongside Chinese socialism, harmonizing the two economic systems which humanity has evolved such that they may become each other's complements, thus contributing to the world's future civilizations. This is what is happening in China today. But does it sound familiar to you? This is the last paragraph of Sun Zhongshan's Jianpo Fangliu and Xuye Qihua. I believe all of you have studied Ma Lianzui, Mao Zedong Sishang, Deng Xiaoping de Li Luan. 你们都学过的吧？所以谁可以告诉我，有中国的特色的社会主义是什么？ Who can tell me what socialism with Chinese characteristics means? Okay. So from 1982, Deng Xiaoping started using this slogan and this phrase, 有中国的特色的社会主义. And then it was not until 1992, until the 14th Party Congress, that changed China's constitution from a centrally planned economy into a socialist market economy. 在1992年，十四大会改变了中国的宪法，从这个计划经济制度改变到这个社会主义市场经济制度。社会主义市场经济制度是什么 ？Socialist market economy. It means using both capitalism and socialism simultaneously. This was actually Sun Zhongshan's idea from his Ming Sheng Zui, in which he said, 资本主义是为了经济发展最快的经济发展的方法。It's the fastest vehicle for economic growth and development. 可是是很不公平。这个有钱的人是越来越有钱，这个穷的人是越来越穷。The rich get richer and the poor get poorer. So you have to use socialism to mitigate out the inequalities of capitalism. That's what Sun Zhongshan said in his Ming Sheng Zui. So my point is that 有中国的特色的社会主义 is pretty much just a slogan, 就是一个口号，没有真正的内容。这个改革开放的政策跟这个有中国特色的社会主义的内容，是从孙中山的思想，孙中山的真心中华的思想出来的。So we just discussed socialism with Chinese characteristics and Deng Xiaoping's open and reform policy. 改革is naturally to reform because the Great Leap Forward and the Mao era, Cultural Revolution brought disaster to China. So the post, can I speak up to 25, 30 minutes? Brought disaster to China and closed China to the world. So, Sun Zhongshan 的思想是开放主义，所以要改革开放，把中国开放。So, after the 14th Party Congress in 1992, after the constitution was changed, foreign direct investment started flooding into China. And in the graph on the left, you can see the FDI, the foreign direct investment, flooding into China.
That's interesting.
And in the graph on the right, you can see, especially from the early 1990s, the growth of China's different industries. So they're like a mirror image of each other. And this is a map, or basically a graphic representation of the State Council's plan for China since the beginning of Gaiga Kaifeng, starting in the south, in the Zhujiang Sanjiao Zhousi, which is a Techu by Hua Zhongguo Kaifeng. Then in 90年, 国务院提出来这个浦东跟上海这个长江三角洲政策。 And then most recently in 2006, 国务院是提出了这个环渤海地区的这个政策。这个是深化了三中三地三个港口三个大的港口的这个理想。 And this is all from Sun Zhongshan's Xue Jihua, in which he's envisioning the development of the Great Eastern Port and the development of Pudong. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. I'm making a. The ECHO Symposium, so please come and join me tomorrow. Thank you very much.